Welcome back, everybody, for another ISSA Talk. This is a special series that we're starting. It's going to be called Ask a PT. Not a personal trainer, though, a physical therapist. Because as personal trainers, we always have questions that are kind of outside of our scope. But I have the honor of having with me somebody who is a physical therapist and a personal trainer. So he has the best of both worlds. I have with me Mr. Chris Gellert. Hello, Chris. Welcome.
Hi, Jenny. Thank you. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thanks for joining us. He's actually been with us before, you guys. I've talked to him before. So you guys are going to get to know this guy. He's got a lot to do in the fitness industry. He is a sports physio, and he's a fitness and human movement expert, you guys. He knows his stuff when it comes to the human body, anatomy, and then also orthopedic conditions and issues that most people have. He deals with both sides of it, right? He's got the personal training side of it, and he's got the clinical experience as a physical therapist. So I'm so excited to have him here to answer your questions. Thank you again, Chris, for joining us.
No, thank you for the opportunity. This has been great. I'm looking forward to continue on and doing this for a long time and answering questions from your audience, getting to know your audience better. Definitely.
Absolutely, guys. So keep an eye out for the social media posts. We post them every month. We're going to ask you guys what your questions are. So if you're dealing with a client that's having issues and you don't quite know how to help them, this is your chance to ask questions and we'll have Chris answer them for you. So we did get a couple questions this month to start us off for our series. But Chris, I want to start off by talking about what is the biggest difference between a personal trainer and a physical therapist?
Yes, Jenny, that's a great question. You know, since I'm both, I just a little bit about me and back up just a second. I was actually in advertising. I wear a suit and I wear a tie every day. And I hurt my back 25 years ago. So I was in the business world and I went and jumped into obviously becoming a therapist, but I became a personal trainer first to go back to school to become a physio. So I think the biggest thing, the difference between a physical therapist and a personal trainer is really what we do in terms of our scope of practice. I think a personal trainer are really, really bright. I think they do a lot to help people. They are extremely knowledgeable, but I think the training is much different. Now, it's a doctorate. You know, I have two masters, which is to me not a big deal, but it's a lot of schooling. But it used to be bachelor's, and then the field went to master's, and then the physical therapy field went into doctorate. So the training is definitely different, whereas personal training, you can have a online degree or even a physical therapy, or not a physical therapy, but a exercise science degree. So there's some similarities, but dissimilarities. I think it's the one thing. The second thing is, I think the, like I said, scope of practice, you know, there's the things that physical therapists that I do that you can't do. And there's other things that I teach and I'm like, this is what you would want to do, but stay in your lane. And it makes our profession really upset. So I think it's education. I think it's scope. And I think it's overall the big picture, but there's similarities, which actually we're doing what? We're trying to help people. So we're both trying to help people or clients. We're both trying to help someone get back to the gym or back after an injury. And the biggest picture is lastly is, you know, how do we do it and the plan that we do it. But the main difference, I think, is our knowledge and our scope of practice, actually, to what you said, Jenny. That's the big thing, Chris.
I definitely think that's key, the scope of practice, because there's a lot of trainers out there. I know I hear people all the time who are like, well, I saw somebody do this. Or I saw, like, at my gym, sometimes I see people doing hands-on stretching. And I'm like, unless you are, like, a licensed massage therapist or a physical therapist, you shouldn't be touching your clients. So there's a little bit of stuff that, you know, that line is a little blurry. So we're here to clear that up a little bit, but hopefully give you guys out there some tools that you can take back to your clients. Maybe if you don't have access to a physical therapist near you, right? Chris can help answer some of the questions that you have. So you can continue to, like you said, help people.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. And I think the other thing too, Jenny, just to throw out there as well, I think my personal opinion is not just because I'm both, but is to ask questions. And I've got to say that, you know, if you're not clear, especially if you don't know someone in your area, like I know, Jenny, you're in Arizona, but like I'm in Massachusetts and I've lived in 7 states. I've lived in Australia. I've been all around. So I've gotten to know a lot of people in different places, but maybe you develop a relationship with a physical therapist and you're like, you know, you like this person better than Chris. That's cool. That's really cool. You know, you like someone else that has better and in terms of better connection. But the biggest thing is try to ask questions and get to learn and really get to understand, you know, where your shortcomings are. And I can help, you know, without a doubt. So just wanted to throw that in there as well.
Absolutely. Yeah, you're absolutely right there, Chris. Okay, so the first question we got, and this is actually one that I had a question about too. Mm-hmm. How common is the condition of scoliosis? I actually work with college athletes, and I've actually had, out of the 70 or so college athletes that I'm currently working with this semester, I've had like three of them say that they have some form of scoliosis. So mm-hmm. can you tell us what scoliosis is and how common is it?
Yeah, so it's common. And I think the biggest thing that you just brought up is that, you know, I remember in high school when I was being screened, and I remember then I'm bending over, leaning and looking at the spine. And I was kind of like, why are they looking at me? And I'm just what, 14, 15, something like that. I forget what it was. Maybe 16. Yeah. Yeah. I don't have any children, so I don't know if you or the aunt has any children, if they still do that. I'm assuming they do that.
I don't think they do, actually. I just heard about that. I don't think they do that anymore.
They don't do anymore. Oh no. Mm-hmm. No. Okay. So that whole four flexion is to look at the curvature of the spine to see if there's a rib pump, which would indicate potentially scoliosis. Now, what is scoliosis? It's basically a lateral curvature of the spine, most often common in the thoracic area. And it's measured by, it's called a Cobb angle. And that Cobb angle is actually like this big angle on an X-ray that typically the physician would measure. And don't call me if I'm wrong, because I'm a little rusty with these numbers, but I think it's 0 to 15 is normal. 15 to 25 is considered abnormal and then maybe bracing, and 25 or higher needs surgery, because there's two types. You have structural, which is how someone is, or a child is born and develops, and there's non-structural, which you develop actually women more than men in their 40s. So basically there's two types, and scoliosis is something that we can improve. But obviously, the earlier detection, the better. Just like with cancer, just like with arthritis, just like with any kind of condition, earlier detection is key. I am asked all the time, can I make someone perfectly straight? And I have to say to them, no. I can't say I can guarantee Jenny or Joe or Bob or Mary, you're perfectly straight. But what I can promise is I'll use all my knowledge and skill set to help them become the best they can be functionally. But the earlier detection, those who are in a Harrington rod and had surgery, I do say have a harder time to get that mobility back than those that are older in life, because obviously there's scar tissue when you have surgery, you have a brace. And so basically there's two types, and the early detection is key. Why is it there? It just happens. It's something that develops over time. And obviously it's something that's can be greatly improved with therapy, even chiropractic care, even with DO or osteopath. So not just us, we don't just see it. There's a lot of other people that see it too, but that's a little bit about scoliosis.
Absolutely. And yeah, one of my private clients had it too. So we can still train people with scoliosis. We just have to maybe be careful about different angles and loading the spine, right?
Correct. Yeah. So if you know, you know, just kind of from a biomechanical perspective, if you know a client has scoliosis, we're talking more than 15 degrees, and they've had an X-ray, they've had some kind of testing done by a doctor, or they have a report, I would consult with definitely the doctor first. Number one, I would get a copy of that, or obviously because of HIPAA, you know, make sure the client can get that, because you can't get that on your behalf. And I can't even do that now. I have to actually go through my patient, where before I could call the doctor, say, hello, I'm Chris, I'm a physio, and can I have a copy of this report? Can't do that. Number two, you want to stay away from really excessively loading exercises like barbell squats. Sure. That was something I once wanted to stay away from. And just excessive, you know, loading to the side. But really, there's not much things you can't do. You want to move. You want to work on improving special rotational mobility. So things like yoga, Pilates are also very effective, not just to do, but to complement training and complement exercising as a whole.
Yeah, I'd recommend those for everybody, right?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Very cool. Okay. So speaking of conditions like this, now shoulder impingements or shoulder issues are very common as well. Very, very well, highly used joint, right? Very shallow joint, very mobile joint. What modifications can we make for clients with a shoulder impingement, which happens again, very commonly?
Yeah. So shoulder impingement, remember, is basically there's a couple of reasons what happens is either the AC joint is narrowed and it's compressing on that supraspinatus tendon. There is either weakness of the scapulothoracic muscles, which are the muscles of the back of the shoulder, or there's a tightness in the posterior capsule, or all three are happening. So the modification that you asked, Jenny, what you want to do is get away from shoulder press. I just think shoulder press is one of those I stopped doing after I fell in the shower and I thought I tore my labrum. And I'm not trying to make the audience laugh or you laugh, but I think shoulder press is okay for the average person. But you know what? I stick with side raises. You're working your medial delt. It really is an effective exercise still to target the medial delt and supraspinatus. But if you know you have a client and the client has shoulder impingement or is going to physical therapy for that, just stay away from shoulder press. So instead of doing the close grip modified, do it alternate here. And focus more on a wider, or I should say, arm side raising approach, and really focus in on avoiding or minimizing chest press temporarily. Work the rear muscles, doing rows, low trap pull down, external rotation, flies, hacksaw, working the lats, you know, are really good. And then once their symptoms calm down, I tell patients to ease back into doing chest press, but I say forever, and I've never had in 20 years, knock on wood, a client or a patient come back and say, you were wrong, is I stay away from shoulder press completely. If they have shoulder press, if they have an impingement, or if they have a rotator cuff tear, I just say stay away. Just stay away.
Yeah, I think that's key, what you just said, though, staying away from bench press, because a lot of people, we train the front of the body, the part that we can see, right? And they neglect the back, not just the bigger muscles of your back, like your rhomboids and your traps and your latissimus dorsi, but the rear delts, right? And then all those little muscles that are part of your rotator cuff that are underneath your armpit. But yeah, I think you're absolutely right. A lot of people need to do more of this and more stretching through their pecs, right?
Yeah, yeah. And it's a lot more men in my career. And so I think, you know, we're designed, men are trying to impress the other significant other or a lover or a spouse or boyfriend or girlfriend. And so, yeah, you just eliminate the pecs temporarily till things are cool. Once things are cool and things are well and there's not many symptoms, ease back into chest. Don't increase the lever. Remember the lever. So if you have a client that's just finishing therapy, maybe start with chest press seated. Now that lever, remember, is horizontally, but if you have benching on the bench, then you're fighting gravity. It's a lot more work. So you want to do more in the transverse plane than try to work in against gravity is a piece of advice that I'd recommend I want out there too.
That makes sense. Yep. Because shoulder impingements are super common. So great advice, Chris. Thank you.
Totally. Yep.
All right. So the next question we got, what is the most common orthopedic condition that a personal trainer will usually encounter?
Well, it's funny. You just actually nailed it. So my first was going to be shoulder impingement. So that's probably the common, but I have some others. So shoulder impingement and rotator cuff are like one and two. They're like brother and sisters. They are very common. Matter of fact, I have probably right now, and just to let you know, Jenny, and I may have told you this when we previously met in the audience, I've been practicing 20 years. I'm working part-time, do a little teaching, other things. But I right now have probably about at least a third of my case or 20-25% of my caseload are rotator cuff shoulder impingement patients. So, so that's the common thing. The next common would be knee arthritis or a knee replacement. Mm. Very painful. I would say to everyone out there, if you want to save your knees, don't squat heavy, don't squat end range, and don't make your clients do those exercises or squat end range. And also pistol squats. Those are exercises that are just excessively load the patellofemoral, tibiofemoral joint. So I'd say my next most common would be knee replacement. That'd be the most common thing that I see. And the resulting is from breaking down. You know, people who work in the industry who, not in the industry, but say work on blue collar or work at construction or electrical, or they're just on their hands and knees, you know, they're doing masonry. It's a painful, painful, painful surgery that once you're done, you're cool, but it's like 4 to 6 months of just, you know, not fun to deal with. So that'd be my second main common orthopedic condition, I'd say.
Okay. I didn't even think about that. And funny enough, my mom has had a knee replacement. So
my mom told my mom might have another. So yeah. And she's trying to prevent it. And so I have her help her doing her thing. She's in the pool. So just a second, I mean, to cut you off, Jenny, but let's talk about how can you prevent from having a knee replacement or maybe
how can we prevent it?
Yeah. So what you do is you want to strengthen more of that posterior chain that you talked about. So glutes, hamstrings, the extensors. I'm not trying to be funny out there with you guys listening, is all the women out there is stay away from, you know, you're doing your spinning, you're doing your leg extensions, then you're doing your lunges, then you're doing your squats, then you're doing Zumba, then you're doing like, it's all quad, quad, quad. Mm-hmm. So you need to work and reduce that load of the anterior chain and shift it posteriorly. Second of all, stretch, stretch, stretch. My family doesn't stretch. I finally get my family to do more. That's another way of preventing knees from breaking down. I do a ton of knee stretching, quad stretching, and particularly hip flexor. And then thirdly, cross training, yoga, swimming, aqua therapy in classes in the water are excellent ways to save the knees. And it's been like shown in the research.
Off the knees.
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
Absolutely. Yeah. A lot of my athletes have knee problems, right? And that my first question is, where is the pain, above or below the knee? And a lot of them have it on the lateral sides, right? The sides of the knee. But then I usually do like the voodoo bands or help them foam roll or stretch their quads. And they're like blown away by how much their pain goes away.
Exactly. And what do we all need? You know, I think, you know, it's funny. I'm speaking at SCW conference next month. And one of the things I'm speaking on is the shoulder inside mobility stability toolbox. And we all should have in our toolbox I think I have it here. Oh, no, I don't. It's upstairs, but that's okay. But I have these little foam rollers, which you probably have at the gym, maybe your house, the audience has, and these little stress balls or fascia balls. So a fascia ball, a stretch strap, you know, are awesome for soft tissue work. Work on the IT band, work on the quad. You know, Jenny, what I'm talking about, and the audience probably does too. Really, really ideal. And that's how you can also help someone with a knee replacement is get in there, have them see a massage therapist. I'm not a massage therapist, but I do massage work under my license, but I'm not a massage therapist. So I don't bill as a massage therapist. I don't come out as a massage therapist. And I refer to massage therapists. I have a great relationship with a couple right now. And I'm like, go see Kent, Cindy, and she's right down the road and blah, blah, blah. So it works out really well, but I think that's some other piece of advice that I'd give the audience as well.
Nice. Yeah. That's a piece of advice that I would give to the trainers out there that are listening to this and watching this.
Yes.
Like you have to incorporate these soft tissue techniques into your training. It's not something
totally.
You can teach them how to do it on their own, but most people aren't going to do it, myself included, right? I don't do it, but if we can build it into a workout where like during their rest or something, they're doing these things.
Or recovery, just recovery. Yeah.
You can do it during sets, right? It doesn't need to be before or after only. You can do it throughout because it's not necessarily going to lead up to injuries or anything like that. If anything, it's going to prevent injuries. It's going to help promote the optimal length tension relationship in that muscle fiber. So get used to these techniques, guys. And if you don't know anything about them, we have our exercise recovery course, or go learn more about foam rolling. Look it up, right? Find some resources and learn more about foam rolling and self-myofascial release. It is huge.
It's huge. And matter of fact,
absolutely.
We'll be talking
now, generally speaking. Oh, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, we're going to be talking at the conference next month, but for those who can't make the conference, and you nailed it, Jenny, go look it up, go on YouTube, Google or look on YouTube. And there's a plethora of great courses out there. I have a course I'm teaching, you know, there's courses by Trigger Point Therapy. There's courses by so-and-so and so-and-so. They're everywhere. It's like Dunkin' Donuts. They're everywhere. So the key thing is, don't try and just use one tool in the toolbox. Look at all the tools, but you nailed it, Jenny, is really work on soft tissue enhancement. Because you said not just those muscle fiber and cells, but you're working on sarcomeres and myofibrils and helping actin and myosin. Remember those things, those thin and thick filaments that we studied a long time ago? You're making those work better within the muscle belly. So the muscle does work. It actually does contract and work on concentric and eccentric training. So yeah, great piece of advice. I compliment it highly. You're right.
Absolutely. Now, speaking about soft tissue and generally speaking here, Chris, what is the leading cause of back pain for most people?
Great question. In my 20 years, in myself included, because I am a present back pain patient, I think the leading cause is probably something traumatic or lifting. And lifting, meaning not lifting weights, by lifting something. For example, I have had several patients or my career lift their child or lift something wrong and they strain their back and they hurt their SI joint. I have had myself, I was in a car accident and I fell down the stairs just because I was stupid. I had the light off because I was always talking, I'm a guy, I don't need the lights on. I can make it down the stairs fine. So soft tissue, you know, you're talking about, stuff I love, Jenny, is you're talking about the skin, three layers of skin, three layers of fascia, muscle, fat, and bone. So I'd say the key or the main is those traumatic injuries and the lifting injuries. And the last is posture, which you nailed earlier. If you're sitting at a desk doing this all day long like this, and you're not getting up every hour, you're gonna be blown away when I tell you, you actually get this. When you're sitting at your desk for hours on end, your back becomes sore and achy because of the following. It becomes achy because we deprive our back or the extensor muscles of oxygen and blood flow. That reduces our pH and it makes it more acidic. So it draws out oxygen, draws out blood, draws out and makes it more acidic. And so our back, the mechanoreceptors, the little fingers in our back are like, woo, and they send signals to our brain. Our amygdala, which is your emotional area where we feel things, are like, wow. And then it goes down the motor tract to where it feels sore. So that's the quick pathophysiology of
where you see me over here shifting in my seat.
Yeah, that me too. And you know, the key thing, which you have a nice chair. I have a nice chair right here. I mean, it's like, it's so comfy. It's leather. It has a nice lumbar support. Invest in a quality chair if you don't have one. When you're not working with clients, and then those clients who are working at the office, who I've always recommended, I strive to give really ergonomic advice. So definitely. Those are the main reasons why.
Absolutely. And what most trainers don't realize, I used to work in corporate, all right? And I'm sure Chris did too, right? Yep. So there are a lot of major companies out there have ergonomics teams within their HR departments, right? So where you can get a nicer chair or get a different chair if your chair is hurting your back. So talk to your clients about that. Depending on where they work, they should go through their HR department and see if they have an ergonomics coordinator or somebody who can help them get a different chair or get a different desk. Like, I'm sitting at my fiance's desk right now, and he has one of those ones that raises up and down so that you can stand at it. Mm-hmm. A lot of companies have that. ISSA has them in our office. So just ask the questions, right? If something's bothering you or this person sits all day, your client sits all day, have them ask the right questions to the right people and see if they can get some tools that can help them help with that pain.
And get up every hour to 2 hours. Tell your clients every hour to two. I tell my patients every 1 to 2 hours, get up, walk around, get some water, go to the bathroom, sit down, do whatever. And that's something I didn't do in advertising, Jenny. When I was in advertising, I'd sit 3 or 4 hours. I'd be typing to the side like this and working on spreadsheets, working on my data, da 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 da. And I was, you know, breaking down, literally slowly breaking down. So I can't stress enough, posture is huge. But you got to get up, got to move. Motion's lotion. Someone told me that. And I can't seem to create that phrase, but I love motion's lotion. It's really great. Right. So
never going to forget it now.
Yeah, never going to forget it.
That's awesome. All right, Chris, you got one more question for you. So this one, I'm not going to lie, you guys, this is my question. Because my fiance, who is almost 40 years old, mind you, he thinks that he can go from like just general workouts, not doing much, to playing recreational basketball. And then every day after he comes back from recreational basketball, his feet hurt, his back hurts, he can barely sit in one spot. Let's talk about people jumping into recreational sports or any kind of activity without training properly for it. What advice would you give to a trainer that has a client that is just getting back into something and they're like, oh, I'm going to go play recreational flag football or whatever it is. What advice would you give them?
I think that's a great point. My advice is, I'm a big hiker, Jenny, and I like to hike. I don't do something like Mount Everest or Kilimanjaro or Machu Picchu. Yeah, that's climbing. Yeah. But mountains are kind of like getting back to a sport. There are levels and stages. And you work with athletes, you know this. You know, look at the NFL, look at the WNBA, these amazing athletes. These men and women didn't become superstars overnight. They put time, Michael Jordan, LeBron, and we can go on and on and on and on and on. All these athletes, Patrick Mahomes, anybody. So the advice I have is, number one, do a thorough, very comprehensive fitness assessment. Find out the client's background, you know, their objective, you know, what they're doing, how they're doing muscular wise, flexibility wise, strength wise, how they move, squat, and look all that. Secondly, look at their history, you know, medical history. Thirdly, what are their goals? when is the last time they exercised? I had a lot of clients. I've had a lot of clients, Jenny, and I'm sure you have had too, who've never worked out or worked out in years. So you don't want to just go from working out, not working out, excuse me, to having to do three sets of shoulders, three sets of back, three sets of legs, three sets of arms, three sets of triceps.
Yeah.
And they're going to be what? They're going to be fatigued. They're going to have DOM syndrome. So I think the biggest piece of advice is get the background data, create a plan, and set objective goals in a linear progression, whether it be a microcycle, which is a weekly goal, a mesocycle, which is a monthly goal, and then a macrocycle, getting back in say 3 to 6 months that you have a goal of getting to play a pickup league or getting to play pickleball or whatever it may be. Where I'm here on the East Coast, I don't know how it is, Jenny, in Arizona, pickleball is huge. Pickleball.
It's getting big here.
It's getting really big. Yeah. I've had a lot of people have injuries from pickleball, and I think they're overdoing it. They're not stretching, and you're thinking, well, why? And I'm like, well, when I ask them, they don't stretch. And I just can tell they don't. So I think that's the best way. You have to get some really good subjective information. You got to get some objective information. So subjective, objective, set goals, use your program design skill set that you learn from ISSA or your personal training certification, you know, whatever, wherever it may be, plan it out, then design, push versus pull, look at the diet, look at their, I'm not a nutritionist or dietitian, but look at, you know, how their fluid and their type of intake they're taking in, and you can help them get to that goal. But you've got to set logical steps, and baby steps is what I would say.
Absolutely.
And that's what I've done.
Huge part of being a personal trainer is creating this program. And it's a chance to kind of flex our trainer muscles, right? And like figure out what are the functional movements of the sport? Do they jump? Do they move laterally? Do they cut? Do they change directions, right? Are they running? Exactly. And then now you get to work on training those things, right?
Yeah, but train, and that's a good point. Train and train them in one plane, then train them multi-directionally. So you're going to do things like leg press or leg curls, which are in the, again, the sagittal plane. Yeah. Or lunges, but then start doing diagonal lunges, reverse lunge with a trunk rotation. So you're now getting some of that, hitting that ball movement, or you can use a sports cord. And once you incorporate these lines of forces, they're going to be like, wow, I never knew how weak I was. But do your assessments, do your core assessment, get something where there's a baseline of where you can start and say, listen, this is how much where we were, this is how far we've come. And this is where we're going to go. And I think that's huge. Make it fun. Give them homework. You mailed it earlier. You said earlier, accountability. Make them accountable. I only have one client right now. I've had her for 4 years. Parkinson's with a shoulder rotator cuff issue. She's doing phenomenal. She's doing awesome. She's on Sinemet. She's taking L-Dopa. She's doing backward lunges with bicep curls. I mean, she's nice. Knocking out of the park. But the reason why she is she's trusted me, but it's based on physiology, program design, and steady static dynamic training. So don't just go right into dynamic things. Build up your static, do your in-place exercises, then build up your dynamic. Definitely.
Absolutely. Yes. That's my favorite part of being a trainer. I'm not going to lie. The progressions and like getting to see how much there is to do. There's like, it's endless, the options that we have.
Yes. But importantly, be safe and, you know, ask a PT. If there's a question, ask a PT. If you can't remember Chris and ISSA, find a PT in your area. Or if you're afraid of, you know, I don't want to talk to this guy, Chris, I'm not offended, but definitely I'm free. I'm available. I'm not going to be charging. I'm here to help you. I'm here to help your ISSA audience. No one else is doing this kind of platform. That's why I'm excited to be here, Jenny, because I think that it's a great, not just experience, but it's a way to give back, but it's also a way to keep that rapport and that conversation going, because our two fields have been fighting for a long time. And I think it's getting a lot better. I think we are. I think we're making amends. And at least my colleagues are. There's a lot of male therapists that have egos, and I don't know what it is. I don't. I feel it is. But ask a PT is huge to be there, and we're here for you. So totally.
Absolutely. Well, we're so glad you could be here for our very first episode, Chris. Thank you again for joining us.
No problem.
Do you have any last pieces of advice as we wrap up our first episode of Ask a PT today?
Yeah, I do. I think the biggest piece of advice is think smart. Never stop learning. I just recently renewed my certification in personal training, and I've been doing this for 20 years. So I went for another certification. I'm going for another, hopefully in the next 3-6 months. I have a goal. I can never say enough about ask a PT. So I'll give you my email in a minute, a way of contacting me. And number four, use the science behind the movement. Don't try to dilly-dally or sugarcoat or take a risk without using the science. I always go back to the science I learned from NSCA, other sources, NASM, and other companies like ISSA, because everybody has great information.
Yeah,
but the science
is a lot out there.
It's a lot out there. Yeah, yeah. But the key thing is, it's not the Gellert method. It's definitely not the Gellert method. I'm never going to call it that. And then for those, again, please reach out. You can reach out to me at PTCG, so Paul, Tom, Charlie, George, 1999 at Verizon.net. I'll repeat that a little slower. It's Paul, Tom, Charlie, George, so PTCG, 1999 at Verizon.net. And what I'll do is I'll make in the future a little stand behind me and some contact ways to get a hold of me. That way so you can see me. But and check out pinnacle-tcs.com, Pinnacle Train Consulting Systems. We're here to help you. So like I said, that's my advice back to you, Jenny, and my words of wisdom for the first session here, or first episode of Ask a PT.
Awesome. Thank you, Chris. And guys, reach out. Let us know when you see our post coming up for questions you have for a physical therapist. Make sure to send us your questions. We will get them answered and we will make sure to post them for you. So Awesome. Thank you so much again, Chris, for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you, Jenny. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely. And to all of our watchers out there, thank you so much for joining us for the first inaugural episode of Ask a PT here on ISSA Talk. We will see you again next month. Have a good one, guys.
Thank you. Bye-bye now.